Hey everyone, welcome to the basics lecture on genes and alleles. We're going to start with some vocabulary, so write down these definitions first. Now you remember that humans are diploid organisms, which means that they have two homologous chromosomes. Every chromosome has multiple genes on it. Let's consider one. Every gene has two copies, one on each chromosome. And if one gene has a slightly different base pair sequence, it's considered a different allele of the gene. Different alleles can produce different proteins or RNA sequences, which will have different effects in the cell. If the two copies on the homologous chromosomes are the same allele, then the organism is considered homozygous for that allele. If the copies are different, then the organism is heterozygous for that allele. Now also, there's a difference between genotype, which indicates what alleles an organism has, and phenotype, which indicates what the organism looks like, its observable physical or physiological traits. In the purple pea plant example, the genotype possibilities are that the plant is big P, big P little p, or little p. The only phenotypes that are seen are purple or white. Now, use your book's glossary to define these words. You'll notice that the definitions do not require an understanding of DNA or transcription because they were defined during Mendel's time. Now, let's spend some time looking at dominance. When dominance is taught the way that Mendel understood it, it's explained like this. True breeding purple flowers are crossed with true breeding white flowers, and the F1 offspring are heterozygotes and are still purple, and that means that the purple allele is dominant to the white allele. Which is great, but what does that mean? What makes purple stronger than white? Well, here is the biology that actually causes simple dominance. It turns out that the purple color is due to a pigment called anthocyanin. That's purple. And two genes are very important for making this pigment. First, the gene on one chromosome makes a protein that's a transcription factor. This transcription factor then binds to a gene on a different chromosome, and this gene codes for an enzyme. The enzyme is needed to catalyze the reaction that turns a pre-anthocyanin molecule into the active purple pigment anthocyanin. The flower can then fill up with this purple pigment, and the flower looks purple. But if there's a single point mutation in the transcription factor gene, so-called little p allele, then the protein that's made has the wrong amino acid, folds incorrectly, and is non-functional. Without the transcription factor, the enzyme gene will not turn on, and so no enzyme will be made. And without the enzyme, no anthocyanin will be made. And without any anthocyanin, the flower is then white. So if an organism has two working copies of the allele, it makes the pigment and the flower is purple. If an organism has two broken copies of the gene, it cannot make the pigment and the flower is white. But what about a heterozygote? Well, Mendel showed us what would happen. When he crossed the pea plants, all the heterozygotes were still purple. And here's the biological explanation. When a pea plant receives a working gene from one parent and a mutant non-functional gene from the other parent, the working gene produces enough transcription factor to turn on the anthocyanin-making gene, which makes a purple flower with plenty of pigment. So now we know enough to actually define simple dominance in cell biology terms. The dominant allele is an allele fully expressed in the phenotype of the heterozygote, and a recessive allele is the allele only seen in the homozygous individual. Punnett squares are used to predict genotype of offspring if you're given the genotypes of the parents. For instance, in this case, we have two parents from the F1 generation that are both heterozygotes. For the P allele that determines the presence of anthocyanin. So the possible gametes from mom are either the big P or the little p, and the possible gametes from dad are the big P or the little p. You can then fill in the table to figure out which or how likely it is that an organism will be homozygous dominant homozygous recessive, or heterozygous. But as problems become more complex, using probabilities becomes faster than making Punnett squares. You use the multiplication rule of probabilities if you're considering independent events. For instance, what is the probability that two pea parents that are heterozygous for flower color will have a homozygous recessive offspring, as shown here? Well, the likelihood of mom giving a little pea is equal to 1/2. She has a 50-50 chance of giving her little pea. The likelihood of dad giving his little pea is a 1 in 2 chance. And so the likelihood of both of these events occurring to create an offspring that gets two little copies is 1 in 4, which is the same as we saw in the Punnett square. But as problems become more complicated, it's faster to do the problems like this. But in some cases, you're considering multiple mutually exclusive events. In this situation, you add the probabilities of each. So if we change the question to ask what's the probability of having a heterozygous offspring, there's two different ways to achieve this. Mom can give the big P, and dad can give the little p, and the likelihood of this happening is 1/2 times 1/2. Or mom can give the little p, and dad can give the big p, and the likelihood of that happening is 1/2 times 1/2. But because we'll accept either one of these as being able to occur, we can add these together. So the likelihood of getting a homozygous or getting a heterozygous can be gotten two different ways, which gives us a probability of 1/2. Just to be thorough, remember that phenotype and genotype are different. The phenotype is the observable trait, and the genotype is the listing of which two alleles the organism has. Our last topic is the test cross. And a test cross is a historical mechanism used to determine the genotype of an organism that's expressing the dominant phenotype, because we don't know whether a purple flower is big P, big P, or big P, little p just by looking at it. To find out, it's crossed with a known true breeding homozygous recessive. If the purple flower, the original mystery parent, was homozygous, every offspring will get a working copy of the anthocyanin transcription factor, and all the offspring flowers will be purple. But if the purple parent was a heterozygote, then one of the copies of the parent will have the mutated allele and be broken. Some of the offspring will get a copy of that little p allele as well, and some of the offspring will be white. In this way, you can determine if the parent was homozygous or heterozygous. A classic part of genetics are the problems that you need to be good at solving. I'll be giving you a short list of problems for you to work on the website, and you should be comfortable with these before taking the basics quiz, because we'll be doing more difficult questions in class. This completes our basics video. Thanks for watching.